Thanks to Squarespace for making this video possible and for allowing me to launch my new Mustard website so easily. More on that after this video. Before Concorde defined what it meant to fly fast, there was another plane that tried to push the limit of speed, the Convair 990. Outside the box engineering allowed it to cruise faster than any airliner before it, and still faster than anything you can fly on today. But while the 990 broke speed records, Convair broke the bank, losing nearly $500 million on a flawed idea that speed would sell airliners. Flying in the late 1950s and early 60s was defined by speed, luxury, and boozy sky lounges. And so, in 1958, American Airlines, looking to one-up their competition, reached out to manufacturers to build them a faster jet, one that could cross the country at least 45 minutes quicker. Boeing flat-out refused. Their engineers said this was impossible, because subsonic jets like their own 707 were already pushing the limit of speed, while still offering reasonable range and efficiency. But one company begged to differ. Convair agreed to build American Airlines their fast jet, an airliner that would cruise at 635 miles per hour. And they even backed it up with a speed guarantee. They'd pay millions in penalties if their new jet couldn't fly as fast as promised. To understand why Convair had taken on such an enormous challenge, you really have to understand what the company was up against. The Boeing 707 and Douglas DC-8 were the first American jetliners, and almost overnight they transformed jet travel from a small niche into something mainstream. Compared to jet-powered airliners before them, these two planes, with their larger size, efficiency, range, and speed, were nothing short of revolutionary. The two rivals sold hundreds of jetliners in just a few short years. But Boeing and Douglas weren't alone. Convair had also introduced a jetliner, the 880, just a year after its rival. The company had a history of building successful propeller-driven airliners and military aircraft. But while Convair's jetliner looked similar to its rivals, the company tried to capture a different segment of the market.
There's been a lot of talk about speed, but there can only be one fastest jetliner, only one speed champion. On its delivery flight, Delta's first Convair 880 became that champion, setting an ocean-to-ocean transcontinental record with an average speed of 665 miles per hour.
To avoid competing directly against Boeing and Douglas, Convair bet there was a market for a medium-ranged, smaller, faster, and more luxurious jet. And sure, there was a market. It was just extraordinarily small. Even before the first 880 rolled off the assembly line, it was clear that Convair's new jet wasn't going to be a sales hit. Orders for the 707 and DC-8 piled up, while Convair could barely sell more than a few dozen 880s. So the company was in a tough position. They had already sunk millions into development, and Boeing and Douglas had already captured the market for long-range jets. So when American Airlines came looking for a faster jet, Convair jumped on the opportunity. They could take their 880 and modify it into something larger and even faster. But there's a reason why Boeing was skeptical. The 707 was already a very fast jet, flying near the limit of subsonic speeds. Beyond subsonic, but before supersonic, is a speed regime called transonic. In this middle ground, drag on an aircraft dramatically increases, so flying here is inefficient. Convair was really going to have to innovate, because their new jet would not only need to be fast, but be efficient enough to fly further than the 880. And the 880 would need more than just a few tweaks to cruise at 635 miles per hour. Convair worked on a new design, called the 990. It would need more powerful engines, so the turbojets on the 880 were modified to add a separate fan system into the exhaust of the engine, creating the world's first turbofan-powered airliner with 40% more power. To counter transonic drag, the aircraft was given a new wing with a 39-degree wing sweep. engineers added large anti-shock bodies to the trailing edges of the wings, another first for an airliner. These would reduce transonic drag and increase the aircraft's critical Mach. They would also serve as additional fuel storage to increase range. With its state-of-the-art wind tunnel tested aerodynamics and new turbofan engines, it looked like Convair had just built the world's fastest airliner, at least on paper. Because when the first 990 took to the skies on January of 1961, problems started to appear. This aircraft couldn't cruise at 635 miles per hour. Turbulence around the inboard engines interfered with the effectiveness of the aircraft's elevators, the surfaces used to control pitch. The anti-shock bodies on the wings, when filled with fuel, caused the outboard engines to oscillate from side to side. Excessive drag areas were discovered all around the aircraft, on the afterbody near the thrust reversers, on the underside of the wing's leading edges, and where the wing joined the fuselage. Convair engineers had to bring in industry experts for help. But as the months and painstaking modifications dragged on, the 990 still couldn't cruise at 635 miles per hour, nor would it meet its range requirements. And by the fall of 1961, American Airlines, in desperate need of new jets, called Convair back to the negotiating table. They reduced their order. At this point, all American wanted was for the first 15 to simply be jets. But the remaining five would still need to be faster versions, and Convair was given more time to work out the issues. The new speed guarantee was now lowered to 620 miles per hour. But Convair engineers persisted, and eventually worked out all the issues. The faster 990A was able to meet the new speed guarantee. And you could say Convair ultimately proved Boeing wrong. The company had built a faster jet, the fastest subsonic airliner ever. Not that it mattered, because by the time it finally took to the skies, Boeing and Douglas were firmly established as leaders in the new jet age. Convair's airliners, with their little bit of extra speed and luxury, at the cost of practicality, range, and efficiency, wasn't what the market wanted. Reportedly, the company lost $500 million building their jetliners, and they'd never build another one again. But the 880, and especially the 990, earned a legendary status, partly because they were a rare sight, and they weren't around for very long. After the fuel crisis of the early 1970s, most airlines couldn't wait to get rid of their fuel-thirsty Convairs. These planes really were the final throes of another era, before flying meant packing in as many people as possible, and when burning an extra 10,000 pounds of jet fuel just to shave 45 minutes off a flight sounded pretty swell. On the morning of May 14th, Mustard didn't have a website. On the afternoon of May 14th, Mustard had a killer website. It took me less than a day to build it with Squarespace, and it was actually a ton of fun to do. I even recorded myself building it. With so many beautiful, award-winning templates to choose from and a completely intuitive user interface, anyone can build an amazing website with Squarespace. Whether you're a photographer, blogger, YouTuber, or run a small business, and if for some reason you ever get stuck, Squarespace has award-winning 24/7 customer support. Start building your website for free at squarespace.com/mustard. And when you're ready to launch your website, use the code MUSTARD for 10% off your first purchase. ¶¶